Classification of surface active agents. There are four classes of surfactants. We can have one, non-ionic surfactants. In these, the hydrophilic group includes polyethylene oxide. The advantages of these are we can have a few of these on a polymer chain, hence increase the affinity for the aqueous phase. The hydrocarbon chain can also be varied. Two, we can have anionic surfactants. These are mostly commonly used because they are cheap. Sodium dodecyl sulfate is an example. Three, we can also have cationic surfactants. These have gamicidal activities. Examples include hexyl trimethyl ammonium bromide and dodecyl trimethyl ammonium bromide. Four, we can also have amphilytic surface active agents which can form both positive and negative ions on dissolution. Proteins belong to this group. We sometimes name surfactants according to their applications. For instance, we can have detergents, which are mainly used for washing, cleaning. We can have wetting agents. We can have emulsifiers, which are used in turning two layers into a uniform emulsion. And we can also have dispersants. Let us look at the thermodynamics of adsorption at interfaces. Now, in these, we are involved with looking at Gibbs adsorption equation. This equation enables the extent of adsorption to be estimated from surface tension data. However, the qualitative treatment involves an uncertainty. Here's the question. First of all, what do we mean by an interface? What is an interface? One answer is, it could be looked at as a mathematical plane. But when we look at it that way, we forget that the adsorbate actually has thickness, and the concentration may vary due to host molecules, as water dipoles in the system. A2, could it be a region or a volume? Here are some figures to try and sort that problem out. In the first figure on the left, we have two. We have an interface SS with two phases, alpha and beta. Here it is a mathematical plane. In the second figure, as we go to the right, again, we still have the interface SS, which we shall call sigma, and the two phases, alpha and beta. But here we are considering the interface as a region shown by the lines, the two lines drawn above and below the mathematical plane. Now, when we look at it that way and examine the concentration of the surfactants in the regions above and below the mathematical plane, we find there is an excess S shown in green on the right-hand figure. If we indeed describe it as a mathematical plane, then adsorption can be described as surface excess concentration. Right, let the amount of component I in the surface phase be Ni sigma in excess of that in phases alpha and beta, extended to SS. Hence, the surface excess concentration of the component I is capital gamma I, which is equal to Ni sigma over A. Here, A is the interfacial area. Capital gamma I can be positive or negative, depending on the position of the SS line. From thermodynamics, the total thermodynamic energy of a given system can be written as U is equal to TS minus PV plus the sum of mu I and I. Similarly, for a surface phase, U sigma will be equal to TS sigma minus PV sigma plus gamma A plus the sum of mu I and I sigma, where sigma denotes the interface. If we differentiate this completely, we will get the U sigma is equal to T dS sigma plus S sigma dT minus P dV sigma minus V sigma dP plus gamma dA plus A d gamma plus the sum of mu I dNi sigma plus the sum of Ni sigma d mu I. That's equation 4. But we know from first and second laws of thermodynamics that du is usually equal to T dS minus P dV plus the sum of mu I dNi. Similarly, for a surface phase, or applying this to a surface phase, du sigma will be equal to T dS sigma minus P dV sigma plus gamma dA plus the sum of mu I dNi sigma. If we now subtract equation 6 from equation 4, we obtain S sigma dT minus V sigma dP plus A d gamma plus the sum of N sigma I, the mu I, will be equal to naught. If we look at the situation under constant temperature and pressure, this equation will become d gamma is equal to minus the sum of N sigma I, the mu I, over A, which is equal to minus capital gamma I, the mu I. That's equation 8. Remember, surface excess concentration is defined relative to an arbitrarily chosen surface. It may be referred to as relative adsorption of solute and solvent. A convenient choice of this dividing surface is one at which the surface excess concentration of the solvent is zero. That is, capital gamma A is equal to naught. Consequently, d gamma is equal to minus capital gamma B d mu B. But we know from solution thermodynamics that mu B is equal to mu B naught plus RT natural log of AB. That's equation 10. Therefore, d mu B will be equal to plus RT d natural log of A, B. That's equation 11. Capital gamma B then becomes minus 1 over RT d gamma d natural log of A, which is equal to minus a little a b d gamma over RT d little a b. So gamma B, capital gamma B, is equal to minus the concentration of CB times d gamma over RT the CP. This is what is called Gibbs adsorption equation. It relates surface excess concentration capital gamma to the concentration CP at a given temperature. For a one-to-one electrolyte, the equation is modified to capital gamma B is equal to minus CP d gamma divided by 2 RT d CP, not the 2 at the bottom of the right-hand side. This is because count ions are also adsorbed to maintain local electrical neutrality. However, in the presence of inert electrolyte, electrical shielding operates and the equation 13 applies. Solubilization. Organic molecules insoluble in water will dissolve in a surfactant solution above the CMC. If you look at that diagram, you will find that the head groups are in one phase and the tails are in the center. The center of the micelle. So this center of the micelle is like an organic solvent, hence organic solute will dissolve there. This is useful in pharmaceutical formulations of drugs containing water insoluble ingredients, in engulfing oil in detergents, in emulsion polymerization, and in micelle catalysis of organic reactions. The Kraft phenomena. Solubility of a surfactant shows a rapid increase above a certain temperature, known as the Kraft temperature or the Kraft point. Before the Kraft point, solubility is low. At and above the Kraft point, micellization occurs, hence high solubility. The Kraft point increases with increasing hydrocarbon chain length.